Stacy stopped at Bill's office door, and she pushed the announce button. A moment later, a buzz sounded. The door was unlocked. She pushed the heavy metal door open, slowly, and then, respectfully, stepped into the room. The office had its own special aroma, filtered but fresh. Fans kept the electronics cool, and little lights flashed on the electronic racks lining the walls.
"I love it in here,"
she said. The video wall screen above Bill's workstation was covered with drawings, formulas, and symbols that meant nothing to the girl. Bill stood up and said,
"I love it better when you're here to share it with me."
Stacy walked across the tiled floor to the chair on the other side of Bill's desk.
"I've been thinking,"
Stacy said, getting right to the point. She gracefully sat down and then smoothed out her skirt.
"So what's new?"
Bill laughed.
"Why are people so incapable of understanding?"
Bill chuckled.
"Stace, I was born on a planet several galaxies away, more than 1,000 years ago, and in all that time, I haven't found the answer to that question."
"But, Dad, I spent a great deal of time organizing my ideas, and then presenting them clearly to others, and in the end, they have no clue what I'm talking about. And if the main idea runs counter to their own concept of how something works, they pick out some little side issue and focus on that, while completely ignoring the rest. Why did I invest all that effort when it is doomed to fail before I even start?"
"You know why, honey," Bill said. "The truth is important to you, even when you are the only one who understands your ideas and the import that they present to the universe. You still have to express what you know to be true. It's both a blessing and a curse."
"But my family is made up of people I adore. My husband, my sisters, my children, all are very important to me. But it's like I'm an alien, and they are all what they think are normal. I want them to understand me, but they can't."
"Well, remember, the others have their own problems with finding peers," Bill said. "Kurt is a math genius and sees things that he can't possibly explain to the rest of you. Angela is also a genius with a paintbrush on canvas. She knows art-related things that none of the rest of us, with the exception of your mother, of course, can even begin to understand. Jennifer is a musical giant and would be able to talk freely with Mozart or Beethoven. But on Addis, she has no one to talk about music."
"Charlene is getting close, though,"
Stacy chuckled.
"Our little sister is cut from the same cloth.
When she grows up, Addis will be treated to some incredible performances by that duet. But my point is that we all have problems connecting with those who don't share our own abilities."
"It's more than that, Dad. You know what I'm talking about."
A small beep sounded, and Bill looked at the wall screen. He studied the readout and then ignored it.
"How are things in space?"
Stacy asked.
"That weather satellite that failed a week ago has been repaired, and it's back online. Those robots in the space habitat are very efficient."
"We hope to take a trip to the space station before too much longer,"
Stacy said.
"Stace, I know that your problem is not exactly the same as the others have. You are a loner. The others all can interface with each other pretty easily. They have fun together, with no fuss or strain."
"How many days did I spend as a child reading a book while they were laughing and having fun together in our home? It was the rule rather than the exception. I have always felt like I am weird."
"You are weird," Bill said.
He looked her dead in the eyes for a moment before he smiled.
"But it's a fantastic sort of weird. Stacy, you have an entire world inside of your head, and no one else can come close to understanding."
"You understand,"
she countered.
"That's because I spent my life just like you have. Do you know what a miracle it was for me when I met Mom? My whole life was lived in isolation and pursuing my ideas. I found a job that was perfect for me when I became an engineer. Suddenly I could work alone and create things that had never existed before. I knew I was doing excellent work, even when almost no one else knew the level of intelligence, creativity, and hard work I had poured into my projects."
"And then Mom came into your life and embraced the introverted man."
"Yes," Bill said. "It was something I never dreamed was even possible. And we latched on to one another like opposite poles of two magnets. I went from being a complete outsider to suddenly existing in the most wonderful relationship that I could imagine."
But you still had to deal with the problem I'm talking about. Mom didn't track with your mind when you were chasing your ideas.
No, Bill agreed. You are the first one I've ever met who could do that. It's like finding a long-lost twin in a way. But Mom could listen and appreciate what my mind was doing, and she opened up an array of other things to me that I had never really known before. Social things, fun things. She has always been my fun girl.
And she adores you. I have seen that love in her eyes all of my life.
I have never understood what she sees in me. She's beautiful and outgoing. She enjoys people, and here am I, a stick in the mud, who looks at her social skills like they are magic.
But why is it that others can't understand a clearly framed presentation of an idea? I write it down, and they get lost trying to read it. I speak it, and they want to go to sleep while I'm talking. Am I truly so inept at conveying ideas?
Bill laughed and looked up at the rock ceiling. It had been more than 3 decades since he and Cookie had landed on this planet. Things were changing every single day, but some things never changed.
Stace, you are not inept. I've listened to you express your ideas many times, and you are always clear and logical in your presentations. What you have to understand is that people simply can't resonate with what you are thinking. For example, Angela loves to talk and laugh and to have fun with others. When she uses our communication channels or our Tri-D equipment, she is excited to use what we have. But if I tried to explain to her how the circuits work or the methods the various devices use in order for her to visit with others, she would mentally check out almost immediately. It would not be because I didn't explain it well either. She just doesn't care about that.
So I'm just wasting my time even trying.
Stacy sighed.
Now that is sloppy thinking,
Bill chastised.
Just because Angie doesn't love electronics doesn't mean my understanding of it and my using that understanding to make her life better is a waste of time.
But most of what I talk about isn't useful like electronics,
Stacy said.
It is about understanding the difference between men and women, and introverts and extroverts, and other things. I want to know why death exists. I want to know why life exists. What is fear? What is love? I wrestle with these things, and when I find clarity on a point, I want to share it. But then I run into that blank stare from others. They refuse to read even short statements of an idea. They get lost, even when I put huge direction signs along the way.
Don't despair, honey. This is not a waste of time, and what you have written will remain on Addis for a very long time. Others with minds like yours will pick up what you have written, and they will love finding your precious ideas there. And if I'm not mistaken, you have a little sister who's growing up in a hurry who will be a lot like you, I am sure.
Susan has a sharp mind, and she's quick. We are going to be very close friends, I am sure.
Don't worry if others don't track with your ideas. Those ideas are important on their own. Your expression of those ideas will still be here years from now, whether anyone else today understands them or not.
But I love my family, and I want them to care about what I'm saying to them.
They love you, Stace. You know that. And I can tell you that even though they don't understand you, they admire you more than you can possibly know.
Okay,
Stacy said.
I've lived my whole life like this, really. It doesn't bug me too much. Jenny has always been very patient with me when I go off into the stratosphere when we are talking.
You two have always been close, despite her musical talents and your philosophical ones.
I don't think it's in spite of our talents, though. Somehow, our mutual respect of things that we don't have ourselves and that we can't really understand forms a little universe with just the two of us, where together we have music in our hearts and philosophy in our heads. I can't explain it, but we have a very close bond.
Bill pushed a button on his console, and suddenly the entire wall screen was filled with an image of a single blue planet. Stacy was confused because she didn't recognize the continents at first, but then she remembered maps that she had seen in history books.
That's Earth,
she gasped.
Is that a history file?
No, it's a live feed. Mom and I had to know what had become of Earth since we left more than a millennium ago. I created a Ferrell-Rose bridge from our galaxy to the Milky Way and then sent a probe through it. It has been in orbit over Earth for about a week, and you won't believe what we have found. The last emperor, Pak by name, was pulled down and executed rather brutally, and then the world empire shattered into hundreds of pieces.
Have you found out what happened since?
Stacy had spent so much of her life reading about Earth history, she was a complete captive to what Bill was showing her.
Oh yeah, Bill said. We captured so much data from this probe that we can give you a play-by-play description of the years from when Mom and I left until today.
Well, don't just sit there, Dad. Tell me everything.
That's my girl, Bill laughed.